Hey guys, what's up? Rossi here, and welcome to the Airgun Experience podcast here for American Airgunner and Utah Airguns. We are kicking things off. Just getting started here with our podcast world, so you guys get to see a little behind-the-scenes videos as we're doing our podcast. So for those of you who are just listening right now, go to youtube.com/American Airgunner, and you can see the full, what we look like and everything. It's crazy. If you're listening to this, you probably know who we are. So today it is me. We have Abby Casey here.
What's up, guys?
We are also joined by the main man here that makes all this possible from Utah Airguns, Justin Jacobson.
What's up, everybody?
And we got a fun guest today.
We do.
Very fun guest today. Flew him all the way in from Africa for this, just for this.
How jet lagged are you?
Right?
Well, at this moment, very bad jet lagged. I had like 3 hours of sleep last night. So I'm going to kick this off the best way I can by saying, first of all, who I am. So for those who don't know, my name is Gerhard. And for the guys up here in the States, easy way of saying it is Gerhard. And I'm from a YouTube channel called Air-Hunter Gerhard, for those who don't know.
Yeah, for if you don't know, you're missing out, because this guy is a rabid hunter out in South Africa, long-range shots. You also, you hate birds. Like, you despise birds. I'd like to talk. Let's start with why such hatred for birds.
What is it to you?
To start off with, you know, one of the biggest or the most target-enriched environments that we can shoot that is pest involved is birds. We've got some of the biggest population of pest bird species on dairy farms and normal agriculture farms back in South Africa. So for me as an air gunner doing pest control and loving those kind of things, the easiest way for me to, how they call it, like your air gunning fix, you need to go to a dairy farm and just smack down some pest birds. First of all, it's nice to do it. Second of all, you're helping out the community. You know, all the farmers are always super grateful if you come around and just to help with the cause.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people don't know how much damage these pest birds do to all these dairy farms and all to all agriculture life. And, you know, when they see us, they really, it's just from ear to ear, big smiles. They just invite us over. And they know, you know, we had to build up like quite a bit of a reputation. Build up confidence when you go to these dairy farms, but when you have that and the farmers tends to know you, it's actually so nice because, you know, they're always inviting and they know you're here for a good cause.
Yeah.
And like I said, for airgunner myself, to get some trigger time, just, you know, when I pull the trigger knowing you're doing it for a good cause, it's just like a double whammy. It's like awesome.
So when you come over here and shoot this match, are you just visualizing a bird's head on your target?
I think the precision marksmanship, you know, the challenge you shoot over there, especially when you have these kind of targets like with pigeons in them and you see some prairie dogs out there and all that kind of stuff, and it gets that little bit of a hunting blood, you know, the hunting fever going. So it's always nice to see that on the range, especially if you're seeing shooting steel. But I think very little people out there do know that I do competitive shooting as well back home.
Right.
For those, you know, don't follow me on social media, I do a lot of bench shooting professionally. So I do a lot of sub-12 bench shooting in a competitive world. I do a lot of national rimfire shooting as well. So, you know, this is all like competitive shooting side of things. And that's what I do for competition back in South Africa. But when I come over here and you're joining up with one of the best, you know, air gun events, the RMAC Challenge, I mean, over here, I take whatever I've got over there with my hunting experience and I apply it down here. And you guys can remember back for me in South Africa, it's like all new stuff here because I can only shoot a bigger caliber, like a 25, 30 cal, 35, 45, 50s. I can only shoot here because back home it's not legal, believe it or not.
So everything you shoot is 22?
Everything is 22. My bench divisions is all 177. Rimfire is obviously 22. And then obviously anything above 22 caliber, I'm not allowed to shoot because it's not legal back home.
Bummer.
That is shooting, gosh, are you shooting a 22 here in the 100 yard?
I am. Match? Well, not in the 100 yard. No.
Okay, what are you going to shoot?
I mean,
that?
I'm going to shoot a 30 cal. And I mean, it's been such.
In the benchrest.
In the benchrest, yes.
Okay.
It's been a gun that's been set up and been trialed and tested and. You know, with me working with FX, I know what these guns are capable of and what they do. And, you know, it's just a gun that works the best for me.
Yeah.
in this division. So I feel the most comfortable with it because I work with these guns basically from day to day. And as a full-time job, that's basically what I do. I work with guys from FX, I work with some ammo developers out there, and that's basically what I do. The best way to use these guns and to test them is basically on these kind of pest control jobs, if you want to call it like that. And I'm also like a big hunter. I mean, I share the passion for hunting. It's just in my blood. The way we've been raised from South Africa.
Sure.
You're 10 years old, the first thing you get in your hand, if you're 10 years old, you don't get an ice cream in your hand, you get a gun in your hand, dude. That's what we get. That's the way we've been born and raised in the farm. 10 years old, I've got my first long rifle and...
Sounds a lot like Arkansas.
I'm telling you.
I had no idea Arkansas and South Africa were
so... You shoot your first buck. You go out there, you shoot your first buck at like 10, 11 years old, and you know, everything from there is just this history.
So for those of you who don't know, we're talking with Gerhard from Air-Hunter Gerhard on YouTube. He's here in Utah right now, in America, for the Rocky Mountain Airgun Challenge. This is a challenge up here in Utah that Utah Airguns throws. It's one of the, it's the biggest airgun shooting competition in the country, and there's long-range bench rest, there's speed shooting, there's kind of a PRS-style competition, there's slug challenges, there's long-range shooting, I mean, there's explosive fire burn. I mean, you do everything. You get like 4 days of like all the shooting you can do. And we're lucky to get a chance to sit down and chat with Gerhard now. I'm curious, man. Longest shot. I mean, you've done this now so long, and you're shooting a 22 caliber airgun. A lot of people listening right now, they don't even know what airguns are capable of. So give me some of those long-range shots you've made with the 22.
In the hunting division, I must say I've taken some really crazy shots. For those guys who have watched my videos, most probably they've seen, you know, crazy shots go down like at 200 yards, 230 yards. And, you know, you can put it on a dime down there, you know, taking that 22 out there, but we have to remember you have to use the right gun, the right ammo, and the good setup. It's always important.
Give me the setup. What's the setup?
I will say, you know, the latest and the greatest these days is slugs. I mean, it's the hottest topic all the way around the world. Airguns have changed and advanced so fast in this last couple of years that I see that the future is basically going to be built in slugs.
Mm-hmm.
The pellet world is slowly, I won't say fading, I say in the competition side of things, it will always be there, because I always think that if you shoot a pellet, it challenges you the most.
Sure.
Shooting a slug, it takes a lot of the, I will say, a lot of the capabilities of a good shooter, it takes it away, because the slug basically does a lot for you. It makes life easier. But if you use it as a tool, or you use it for a method of making your life easier, especially if you want to do hunting, pest control and stuff like that, slugs the way to go. That's where you want to go to down.
Okay.
And coming back to this, that kind of point, if you go out and you do those kind of jobs, you do hunting and stuff like me, and you can't get close enough to your prey and you want to shoot them, long range shooting is basically where you want to go to. Because, you know, I'm a big chap. I'm like 130 kgs. That's what, 260 pounds?
It's large.
I'm a big dude. So
big guy.
For me to run around behind my prey and my targets that I need to shoot, it's going to be a little bit impossible. For me, putting a slug in there, shooting my prey out like that, 200 yards, 150, you know, staying with that in that range, it makes my life easy. You understand?
Sure.
I'm talking about...
What did you say the longest shot was?
So the longest shot, coming back to the point, is I've taken ridiculous shots. I think 230 yards must have been the longest shot on a normal pigeon.
Mm-hmm.
I did the, what was it, the air gun challenge where everybody shot the golf balls. I think I shot my golf ball at 310 yards.
310 with a 22.
26 grain slug, 310 yards, and I did it in shot number 4.
How perfect of a wind day did you have?
Well, that was very perfect. And believe me, it's not always first time around, first time shot, first time hit. It doesn't happen. We've got to be realistic. For me as a hunter, I always say, I can do the shots all the way out to 300. You can take that long bombs at 400 or 500. You can do that if you wanted to. If you put the time in, you can do it. But being realistic, I feel very comfortable from all the way from 0 out to 200. With these slugs in 22 these days, it's easy.
Yeah.
I will say.
I thought we broke your PR. I thought you broke your own personal record when you were here last time.
Well, that was for ground squirrels. That was kind of distance on that prey.
Oh.
Okay. What's your longest shot on a ground squirrel?
Well, the longest shot was 185. It was 185 or 183, I think, the last time.
Are you talking about meters or?
Yards. That was yards.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
That was, something.
What are you thinking? Spit it out. What do you, what?
No, I just,
I can't remember everything, but we did some long bombs. I mean, we'd been, some of the stuff that we shot was like over 200. The one that popped up my mind, which was really like a crazy shot with that kind of wind conditions, was like 180.
Yeah.
And you know, ground squirrels, they are very, I mean, let's face it, they're not that big. These things.
No,
are,
you're talking about like a half dollar.
Yeah.
Right?
Hitting your mark. Hitting your mark out there.
What are you thinking? I feel like you've got a story in your head. Because I know you've hit some ground squirrels at crazy distances.
Just tell me which one are we talking about? Because we did rock chucks, we did actually so many teams in the base already.
What did you ask, like, what's your long shot on a species?
No, I want to know your longest shot.
Just what's your longest shot ever with?
Well, I asked with a 22.
Yeah,
I asked
with a
22.
Yeah,
with a
22. Yeah, with a 22. Yeah.
No, I'm sorry.
No.
What's your longest shot ever?
No, the longest shot. Airgun was like hitting mark 400 yards, 22 caliber. That was on a soda can. Putting it down, shot number 9. Down.
Did you have a special scope?
I had a kick-ass elevated plate on my rail to elevate that scope, and I dialed that thing to the max. And I held over another, like, I think it was like 10 or 12 bolts on top of that still.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Zoomed all the way
and
out.
The best,
you
know, when
you
shoot long range, it's always so nice to, the best part for me is the sound, you know, the sound feedback that you get. Because you pull the trigger and you wait. There's like that kind of delay. You wait, yeah, like wait, and then, oh yes, it's done. It's done. You look down range and it's down.
And this is the kind of stuff people can see on your YouTube channel.
Yeah,
you...
I do those kind of shots a lot of times. Like I said, I need to always stick into good ranges, which is very much possible.
Yeah.
Because as a clean, ethical hunter myself, I like to put out, you know, shots that is capable, and I need to make sure that what I hit, I do take down clean and humane. I'm not a guy for taking stuff down that's, you know, gonna suffer. And it's just bad hunting. That's just my philosophy.
Sure.
Especially with hunting and things.
All right, so here we go. So a couple rapid fire questions. Gun of choice.
FX Impact.
Pellet of choice.
Asian Indian Slug.
Slug of choice.
Well, H&N slugs, pellet of choice, I will say definitely, it depends. For 22, I will say 18 grain Barracuda or a 18 grain JSP.
Mm-hmm.
If we go up in calibers, I will say for 30 cal, definitely the JSP 44 grainers.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just on the money. And then as you progress up in the slug range, at the moment, I will say, I think Nielsen's really do a very good job at the moment on the bigger caliber slugs for the big balls,
because mm-hmm.
that's most likely which I see most of you guys shoot, like Texans and stuff like that, and I see the Nielsen slugs, they really do well those big ball guys.
Yeah.
They're really accurate.
Yeah.
So that next question, favorite gun to shoot when you come to America and can shoot the bigger stuff?
Well, if it is definitely, if we're going up big ball,
yeah,
I will say the Texan is the way to go.
Yeah.
I mean, it has just been built for big, heavy, big game animal shooting. I will say the Texan is definitely going to be the way to go. But I will say that the FX Impact is definitely my gun of choice. It's like a third arm. It's part of my body already.
Yeah.
It's intertwined in there. And I will say that the 35 caliber FX range that we're working on and the development we're doing now is actually coming up quite a bit. So
yeah.
I think soon enough, you know, for me, I think the FX Impact is really going to be, it's going to be the full all-round gun for me at the end of the day. That can shoot anything from the bottom from 22 all the way up to a 9mm 357. I mean,
with an FX Impact, down in South Africa, you're out in the mountains and the fields and you're shooting birds. I mean, you change the 22 barrel to a 357 barrel.
Oh,
is anyone
dude.
Really going to know? Like, it's not
dude.
Any louder.
Listen,
like,
I've got to be honest with you, but the temptation is so, so high. I'm telling you, the temptation is so high. And we do a lot of fun hunting, like dassies and monkeys and baboons and stuff like that. I do a lot of centerfire shooting as well. You know, I love the 22 250s and 260 Remington. I'm shooting back home and those. But for me, I think the airgun is just the way to go. Unfortunately for me back home, if I shoot larger animals like big varmints, like you know, baboons, we've got very big baboons back home.
Yeah.
You gotta go over to like a, you know, 22.50 or 260, you gotta shoot them there. But if you shoot like smaller monkeys, like smaller varmints and like geese and, you know, those kind of things. 22 can do it all. I will say in this, in the power range, you're really shooting back home. And I think this is one of the reasons why the 22 caliber impact and advancement in the in that industry has boomed so much.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the only thing we can do back home. So we put all our effort and focus on it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think just in, you know, in the beginning, the 22s was like normal. And then suddenly the advancement in the 22 range was just skyrocketed.
Oh, for sure. Well, yeah, slugs have changed the game entirely. That's the bottom line.
Yeah.
So
it's definitely been
distance shooting slugs have totally changed the airgun industry in the last few years.
It's been crazy. So, I must be honest, myself working along with these kind of companies and you know, seeing how we progressed in this last couple of years, what's going to happen in the next year? That's what we have to ask ourselves.
Next year, right? Next 10 years.
Yeah,
that's gonna be,
what's going to happen?
Crazy. So we'll have center fire equality air guns very, very shortly. I mean, I think.
Well, I won't say, you know, as you know, yes and no.
I mean, you're not gonna be shooting 1,000 yards on a line, but I think you're gonna get to 22 caliber equivalent, you know, maybe 9mm equivalent with some of these.
You're already getting on the mark with your rimfire territory and your 22s on the airgun side of range. Is
yeah.
Right there now.
I mean, it might not be 22 to 22. It might be like a 30 cal to a 22.
Yeah,
or something. You know, 50 cal is equal to a 9mm,
sure,
something like that. But you're gonna have those similarities. I gotta go back to the monkeys and the baboons. We just kind of skipped over that like it was like ground squirrels and pigeons.
Yeah.
It is an effort.
That's something I want to know, because a lot of people are like, what? You shoot back the cute little monkeys in the zoo? But there's a reason they're in cages, right? These are nasty little creatures.
These things are, you know, the big thing is, you know, usually when it goes to media, everybody see them.
Mm-hmm.
They always showcase this beautiful natural environment where they like jump around in the trees and they sit in the sun, you know? They just, they look so peaceful.
Yeah.
You know? Bang at the ranch, things are not the same because these things are quite vicious. We gotta face the facts. These things got, the baboons got one of the biggest canine fangs on them. If that thing takes you head on, you're gonna lose. I've seen several animals being taken down by these baboons, and I promise you, I don't want to paint the picture. It is just bad.
I mean, they're omnivores, right? They eat meat and
everything.
Vegetation.
Yeah, they eat
everything.
Anything. So whatever they can scavenge and what they can get.
And they carry a lot of diseases?
They do a lot
nasty.
Of, there's a lot of rabies going around. I mean, the same kind of things. What are you going to
tell them the story, how the regular monkeys, how they can tell if the electric fences are on
so,
the villages.
You know,
listen to this story.
So I was part of a project back in South Africa, and we actually, one of the biggest projects we did is fencing up the natural reserves where all the wildlife is on the one side, and we people build up the city areas, you know, down Cape Town.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're trying to do is, in some of these, you know, projects, we're trying to fence the wildlife away from civilization so that they can't come over and cause problems. It's like raccoons in your backyard,
right,
causing problems, you know, scavenging around. It's the
like
same kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So baboons is just multiplied, I will say, by 100. Dude, these things is like completely crazy. And we've got this big electric fences trying to push them away, to keep them away. And the male baboons walk next to these fences. Now they've learned, they're so, so clever, the baboons. They are super, super clever. If you remember, these kind of baboons, they open up car doors. They know how to unlock doors. They know how to use keys. They know how to spot people with food. They know what is a woman. They know what is a man. They know that the man is stronger than a woman. They've actually adapted in civilization.
Don't take offense to that.
Yeah. But yeah,
even
no offense.
Even that would be stereotypes.
She's thinking, I will arm wrestle you, Gerhard. I don't care about your 260.
But
she's 60.
Yeah.
60 versus 260.
There you go. So these, they are very clever. And one of the things I've told Justin as well, one day I was in the, you know, in a forest area, and this male baboon was walking next to the electric fence. And, you know, we've, as scouts, we watch them and, you know, see and, you know, we take notes how they, you know, act up and stuff. And there was a female baboon walking with a little baby underneath her, you know, latching on.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw this big baboon, you know, walking over to the female. And I thought to myself, this is like odd. You know, what is he going to do now? And he just yanks this little baby off the male, female baboon, and chuck that little baby straight onto the electric wires.
To see if it was electric?
To see if
so
it was on.
So the baby screams, the fence is on.
Yeah, the baby screams like mad, gets shocked, and you can hear the thud of the electricity going off. And that little baby baboon just like jumps away and it falls on the ground, and the mommy's like running and grabbing it, and the female, the male just walks proudly off like, nah, it's on, let's move along. And it goes
not
on.
So cute.
Not so cute.
What?
Disease, right? Giant canine,
yes.
Murderous,
be
devious.
Yeah.
Just, it's like a bunch of little teenagers running around, just chaos.
Like
opening doors, come breaking into cars, taking their stuff.
When they come in, they just physically destroy houses. I mean, you're talking about a couple of hundred grand worth of damage. They go in there, first of all, they just break everything inside the houses. Second of all,
the teenagers.
Yeah.
Like
they're like really are like just vandals.
And they basically
let's
put it in a nice manner. When they're all done with everything, they just leave you a nice little boop on the table to say thank you. I've ruined your house.
I'm out.
Yeah. And that's a gift wrap for you.
Yeah. So there you go. That's the thanks I'm giving you.
All right. I could hear these monkey stories all day long. It's always great talking to Gerhard. He's an epic hunter. If you guys don't know who he is or where to find him, go to YouTube and you can see him at Air-Hunter Gerhard, G-E-R-A-H-A-R-D. Gerhard. Gerhard.
There you go. That's close enough.
Air-Hunter Gerhard. And check out his videos, man. Great hunter, educational. Well, definitely if you're a long distance shooter, FX shooter, he can help you set up your guns. Mm-hmm. You give all your setups on every gun from Impact 1 to the M3, right?
The guys must never be afraid also to drop a message. I will get back to them, you know. If I get a chance, I will definitely answer questions and stuff on my channel. So anytime, just drop a message, I'll get back to the guys.
Awesome. That's it. Thanks, you guys, for listening, and thanks for watching. Make sure you go to AmericanAirGunner.com for more podcasts, more YouTube videos, and all the air gun knowledge you want. Of course, if you are looking to buy air guns, Utah Air Guns is the place to be. See you guys next time.
That's right.
Appreciate you guys.
Cheers.